was near my house.
Good evening. My name's John Pereski. I'm the chairperson of the Capital Improvement Planning Committee. And we're here tonight as part of a joint public hearing with the Deerfield Selectboard on the town's proposed capital program for fiscal years 2018 through 2022. I have a handout of the capital plan if anybody would like one. Basically, it includes various repairs for the elementary school. For fiscal year 2018, it includes various repairs for the elementary school, vehicles and other equipment for South County Emergency Medical Service, some voting equipment for the town hall, and several public works improvement projects. I have copies of the report here. If anybody wants to come up and take one. Other than that, I guess.
They're also available at the select board's office through our town administrator.
Okay. I'll give everybody a second to take a look at the report and let me know if they have any questions.
Oh.
Oh, yeah, we'll get to it.
For emphasis,
somewhere here.
I handed out my copy too.
Yeah, I don't know where I have my copy.
The 2018 amounts were approved by the Capital Improvement Planning Committee.
Thank you.
The other years, 2019 through 2022, is just what might be needed. It's not approved. It hasn't been approved for appropriation. It hasn't been approved to go on the town warrant. It's just something that might happen. It might not. It might. There might be things that maybe a year from now we'll find out we need to add something to this program. Maybe a year from now we'll find out we can delete things or amounts will change. So again, for emphasis, 2019 through 2022 is not cast in stone, as they say. Just what might happen. With that, I guess I'll open the meeting up to questions. No questions? Does that mean we can adjourn?
Yes, we can close the hearing. Oh,
we have one
question.
We have a question. Okay.
Bruce has always got a question.
Bruce Hunter, St. Gully Road, South Deerfield. With the Deerfield Elementary School, have they submitted a five-year plan? I see 3 years, 18, 19, and 20.
We are going to work on them submitting further out projections. Kip
no,
is going to.
No, my understanding they have a five-year plan.
No, they don't have a.
They
haven't.
Not?
No. We were.
I think 3 years, maybe, if I remember right.
The other question is, do we own Frontier High School, Regional High School?
We were not able to get anything from Frontier.
But they have a plan, five-year plan.
I'm not sure.
They wouldn't go on this anyway, would it? It's their own district, right?
Well, but it would come.
Patty.
Yeah. Patty, do you know if Frontier has a five-year plan?
Well, Deerfield Elementary and Frontier, back in the fall, we started our five-year plans.
Okay.
So that they do exist. The biggest problem is there's no pricing. The projects that need to be done are there, but you can't price something for 5 years down the line. It's too difficult. Vendors don't come in and give you prices because they really don't have any money. So we have the list of projects for both the elementary school and Frontier. It just has no pricing on it.
Okay.
Well, I think we should have that included, at least a list of items. And Frontier.
Well, I'm sure. That's what we're going to work on in May. In May 16th, we scheduled a meeting at 5:30, and we'll work on trying to get that information from the schools.
All right.
We worked really hard.
We own the building, so we are responsible for any building repairs, maintenance, or is that between the district? The district, I mean.
It has, in different years past, I mean, sometimes they come forward of that year with a repair list, and sometimes we get, like, long-term projections, and they, and then we have able to discuss it, but usually we haven't been very, I mean, I'm very glad to hear from Patty that they are working on a five-year plan, because we've not had that kind of information in the past. And I've been on the committee for, I was a planning board rep when it first started, so I can honestly say we've not had a lot of information from the schools in a, you know, as a plan and projection of projects.
So with Frontier, it's a district?
Yes, but they usually give us...
And each town would have its own warrant article?
Yes.
So CIPC very well might not see...
In the past, they haven't.
That's correct.
In the past, they haven't, but we have tried to reach out to Bob Lesko and tried to get some information on this.
But does CIPC want that information?
No, I don't think it's in that purview.
That's my question.
Because it's not part of the town of Deerfield.
Well, that's where the confusion might have.
Well, I would like to review what they have.
That with Frontier is that the regional agreement does not address capital needs.
I know.
So there is no methodology for us to assess the towns. So the last time we tried this was, I think, my first year.
Oh, yeah.
And we put it on every town warrant, every town warrant something different. So it was like one project that everybody approved, it had something to do with the locks. And so that wasn't a very good way to go through the process. So when Superintendent Barrett came on, she put a long-range capital committee together, and we never got any, we met, I believe Mr. Olmstead was on that group, and someone else from the town of Deerfield, the finance committee, and we never got any, nothing came of it. So right now, we're talking about, do we need to modify the regional agreement? Do we just want to put the projects together, have the committee vote the projects, and then we go out to bond and have the town vote for financing for the projects? So we're working on it, but right now, the problem is there's no mechanism.
Gotcha.
This is just my personal...
I think it'd be a good idea to have a mechanism.
Yes, but just my personal preference. It would be nice to have it go through our capital committee and our select boards, so that we, as part of the budgeting process, because it's hard to get the warrant article in the spring and, you know, just have it plunked down. So it'd be nice to have some input. I know it was really awkward, because I remember that year, but we did review the capital projects, and I think what happened is all the committees, they had different committees in each town, looked at them and adjusted them, and so I understand it is not really awkward, but the idea of having it go through a review process and a planning process is still a really good one. So if we can get some long, yeah, if we can get some long-term information, I think it would be good.
Do you need to email the five-year plan to Wendy?
Yeah, that would be great.
I do have a copy of, I thought it went 3 years, but maybe you're right, maybe it is five. I do have a copy of that.
But we did it like 1 to 2, 3 to 5.
That's right. Yep. And I think I gave that to someone. Yeah.
And my other question is, Tilton Library, we're holding off on any capital improvement plan until we hear about the grant?
Well, the idea was to wait until... I mean, we will know in July where we are on the list.
So at that point, if they don't get it, they'll... I see Tilton Library parking expansion is listed. And no date, no amount, no date. Has that been a request, or is that just...
No, it was on there because that was one of the things that they were thinking of. But we decided early on in the committee process to not go forward with the Tilton Library improvements or their requests until we knew where they were on the list and what we were going to do
they
as a town.
They haven't made a request.
Well,
they really haven't made a request.
Well, not a formal.
No,
a formal
the request came in, and then we asked Sarah to withdraw them. What?
That
was
a request from the Highway Department, parking lot improvement.
Oh, was it? Oh, okay.
Thank you for
clarifying that. But Sarah had brought forward some requests, and I had talked to Sarah and Nancy and asked them to hold off on them until we figured out where we were with the process in the library, because it didn't make sense to invest in some of the...
No, I understand that.
Yeah, so the requests were withdrawn.
But once we know, then if it's 4 years down the road, 3 years down the road...
We can start planning.
It will be a five-year plan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It was our choice, or our request.
Maybe I shouldn't bring it up now, but if the high school makes a capital improvement, wouldn't it be the assessment for that be divvied up among the member towns?
Yes.
Right.
But what happened, what Patty was referring to, is they brought forward a plan for capital, and I forget what it was, but we voted an amount. I think two of the towns voted the same amount, and the other two voted two different amounts. And it was messed up, and it ended, and there was only one item that was all had the same amount.
So they already called us out, the only one that we could do?
Yeah.
I see.
So, and that was the last plan that we had seen, and that, I don't know how long ago that was. That was 5 or 6 years ago. That was before you were organizing us, John.
Way back when. It's a joint hearing. You can ask if there's questions, too.
No. If there are no further questions, then I will close the hearing and start with the main meeting tonight.
Does this mean I can...
Yes, you can go, John. Well, we have to vote to adjourn the hearing.
Oh, okay. Do I hear a motion from the capital improvement people?
I'll make a motion to adjourn the public hearing.
I'll second it. All those in favor?
Aye.
And then Select Board will make a motion.
Make a motion to adjourn the public hearing?
I'll second.
Second, okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
All right. Thank you very much, Jack and John.
Thank you for your hard work.
Roger and Jeff. Chris, do you need a couple minutes before we start a Select Board meeting?
I think he does.
Okay, great. Welcome to our pre-town meeting, April 19th, 2017, public hearing here in, well, not a public hearing, hearing here in Deerfield Town Hall. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, thanks. I could have used that.
Finance Committee, if you'd like to join us at the table, it's set up for you to be here.
The Finance Committee, please come up.
Do you want to recite the...
Yes.
Yes, we will.
We will introduce ourselves.
While you're at it.
I'm taking a seat, John.
There you go.
Evers, you.
It's me. There you go. Sit here or not.
My mind's made up, but I have no choice.
Mary, would you like to start with your, with you, with your name?
What?
Your name.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. Mary Stikarski, I'm on the Finance Board and the Personnel Board.
Jeff Upton, Finance Committee, Capital Improvement Committee, and Sewer Study Committee.
John Pereski, Finance Committee, Capital Improvement Planning Committee, and Sewer Committee.
Bruce Hunter, Finance Committee, and Sewer Study Committee.
Skip Olmstead, Finance Committee.
Trevor McDaniel, Selectman.
Carolyn Ness, Selectman.
Kip Camosa, Selectman.
Bruce St. Peter's Finance Committee and Sewer Study Committee.
Wendy Foxman, Town Administrator.
Okay. We have the warrant. Everyone has a copy of the warrant. Did everyone get one?
No,
is interested in one? Oh, John hasn't. And Finance Committee recommendations for the budget.
Yeah. I've been very good.
Wendy?
Is Charlie Konecki here? I thought I saw him earlier.
He was.
He was. Was Charlie here? Yeah, I don't know where he is right now. Oh, okay. Wendy, do you think you could go get him?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, does anyone have any questions in general before we start? We were just going to go over the warrant. Yes?
I'm not sure exactly what happens. What exactly is it?
Well, this is...
Question.
We've done it a couple different ways, and I think we've decided that we wanted to do a combination of the other couple meetings that we've had in past years. The idea is that it's very difficult to get through the whole warrant. The warrant is the 30 articles or 32 articles that we have. It's really hard to get through them in one night and have a huge discussion of any one article. It's not that we don't want to discuss them, but what we would like to do is go over most of the articles and see what questions people might have so we can get more answers if we don't have the answers, but also have the ability to explain the thought process that we got to in the warrant articles, like the budget process, and just give people a little bit more time to digest it and have information. So that's basically what it is.
It's informational, so that you'd have time to kind of think things over before town meeting on Monday.
And if you had more questions, you can certainly get Wendy to take your question, and we can do some research on it. Because not always we think we're prepared, but we're not always prepared for every question. So does that sort of figure out? Yeah. Okay. So,
Patty.
Patty, yes.
Yeah, I have a question about an article that's missing from the warrant.
Oh, sure. Okay.
The school department, the Frontier Regional, had submitted an article back in the fall before Ms. Boxman's arrival to say at your next special meeting or your town warrant, we wanted permission to repurpose money that the town of Deerfield had given us to refurbish the central office on 219 Christian Lane. And we asked that we use that money and to have the town vote that we could use that money to modify the offices at the Frontier Regional High School. Apparently, due to a miscommunication about a possible late coming warrant on the library media roof, Ms. Boxman and Dr. Carey had a miscommunication that there wouldn't be any warrant article. But we meant for the roof. We didn't mean to erase the one we've already requested. So. It's kind of a little bit of a
The problem is it's not on the warrant, so there's not much we can do about
it,
right? Because it's not
published. We talked about this earlier. I did not know they still wanted it, and I had an email implying to me that they didn't have any articles to give us. I can see how you could read it just for the school roof, but we had our town meeting and should have been a reminder or let us know if you still want that. And I thought someone actually told me one of the towns hadn't passed it, so no. Were you the one?
No, I thought that Sunderland didn't pass it. I didn't think it was going forward. Am I mistaken?
Wakey's already passed it at the special town meeting, and it's on the warrant. My understanding is on the warrant. I know it's on the warrant in Conway,
yep.
And my understanding is that it will be on the warrant in Sunderland.
Oh, okay. I was under the impression it didn't pass Sunderland. I couldn't understand why, okay. But...
So we have misinformation. I'm very sorry about that, and we'll do whatever we can to correct it.
But it won't happen in this town meeting.
Yeah, she knew.
Yeah.
And that's kind of an issue because the money's supposed to be the other three times. So
Well.
Yeah. I didn't have special town meetings. It's about the only way we can.
Yeah. We'd have to republish and do another warrant.
There's no air conditioning in the section of the high school where they were.
I have a question about the budget. If it's a level funded budget, or is it an increase from last year, or are we facing a 2.5% override.
There's no override. It is an increase. It's an increase of about 4.5%, and it's an increase of 4.5% because we've included the snow and ice overage of about $117,000, and we have $200,000 for capital stabilization account we're going to fund for the first time. We're going to establish, hopefully establish the account and fund it. So those are those two expenditures alone have driven up the entire budget. But in general, it's a level services and basically a level funded budget.
How is it level funded where all the salaries and stuff in our insurance reps, it's not really level funded?
It's not.
You know what I'm, you know what
yeah,
I'm saying?
It's level services and it's not yeah. anything mm-hmm. out of the ordinary. It's, we're trying to keep it, like I said, very stable.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Salaries and benefits increased for town employees from about 7.5 to 8%. That includes all the elementary school in the union and all their employees, plus the police department union. So we had a significant increase, over $250,000 in salaries also from last year.
But we were able to cut in different places so that it's basically, you know, comes in where we have targeted. We try never to go above 2.5-3%.
Or 4.
Well, we're going to start. Would you, are most people here comfortable going through the warrant first, or would you rather go through the budget first? Are most of you here for budget questions?
For specific questions.
Or specific? There, it would be really nice if we could go through the budgets, because I have Charlie Konecki here to talk about the Board of Health budget for the mosquitoes. And that is one that is not recommended by the Finance Committee, but it is recommended by the Select Board. So
part of the Select Board.
So if we could do that, I'd really appreciate that. Would that be okay with people so that Charlie could go home? Thank you, Charlie, for coming. We'll where's the Board of Health budget? We want to go down to 500. Okay. This is the Board of Health budget. It's on the second page in the 500 series. Requested is $35,530 and recommended is $24,530. It's basically the $11,000 that we are contracting with Vector Disease Control Incorporated to do the trapping. We have gotten another year free from the state to do testing. So, Charlie, could you give us a little background on why it's important to do this test, you know, the trapping and testing, and what we're trying to achieve?
First of all, a little background on myself. I'm a retired state district health officer. Part of my task out in Western Massachusetts for years was monitoring of diseases. Mosquitoes were one of.
Mic's working?
I don't think that mic has been working.
It looks nice.
Talk into it.
All right, I guess I got a really.
Well, they're both on, but
you just got to get close.
Just talking to
how's this? Is this better?
Yeah, here we go.
Let's
Charlie,
do this.
Hear your singing voice.
Hi, I'm Charlie Konecki. I'm a retired district health officer from the state of Massachusetts. I retired about 2 years ago. Part of my job was disease surveillance in Western Massachusetts. Every kind of disease you could think of somewhere down the line, the state would send us out to take it to establish and try to determine what caused, what direction, so on and so forth. One of the things that we worked on was mosquito surveillance. Even though these programs were all called mosquito control, they really are mosquito surveillance programs. The programs are set up so that we can determine what types of diseases are occurring in a given area and if they are a threat to the people and the livestock. These surveillance programs were sporadic by the Commonwealth. and they faded away as budget cuts came through. The only mosquito surveillance that's going on now are mosquito control districts that have been established since the 1920s. They were established because of diseases like Triple E, which were basically fatal, and people needed to know about this long before they became an issue in the region, so the mosquitoes were the first sentinels to let us know that there was a problem. What's happened in the Pioneer Valley, Deerfield included, is there's an increase in our populations out here. With that, there's an increase in our activities in the evenings. Therefore, there's more exposures to these types of insects. The problem is, we've never kept up with the curve of doing monitoring out here. And that's a concern, because without the monitoring, we don't have a trigger to know what else we need to do to protect ourselves. Presently, what's happening is a number of communities in the area have banded together for a grant to try to actually establish a mosquito control district. We have them all over Eastern Mass. We have one out in the Berkshires. There's absolutely nothing up and down the Connecticut River. Deerfield is one of the communities that's been pushing forward to try to be a lead community to make this happen. So that's a quick and dirty summary. You have a lot more going on. I actually sit as selectman in my hometown of Southampton. This was up until 10:30 last night going over our lawn for our annual town meeting. So I'm going to open up the floor. Do you have questions?
I think what's important, Charlie, if you could just, the reason why we're surveilling the mosquitoes is so that we can warn the public, but also the advantages of participating in a district which we're trying to form is that the wetlands exemption, so that we can clean out ditches. Yeah. Okay.
The reason you want to form a district is because it streamlines the approach to take and do surveillance, and it streamlines the activity of doing treatment. You basically bypass a number of the wetlands regulations doing this. It also takes and acts as a conduit that you can get money through the state if there is an emergency. When you take and privatize this and hire a company to do the surveillance, they go basically where the money is. Right now, there's nothing going on, they're covering everybody, so on and so forth. But if there becomes hotspots in a certain area, they pull personnel to take and deal with those hotspots, your surveillance drops off. There's a lot of merit to having a district in this area. And I will tell you the downside, because I also am on the town board. It becomes a district, so it basically ends up being another district that has a committee that oversees it, and they determine what the tax levy limit is going to be on that operation.
However, we're setting our district up as a voluntary district, so there will be a base fee of, we're hoping enough communities will join in, so it'll be $5,000 to $10,000 to join, and then when you have, and that will give you a certain level of surveillance. And if we have issues, then lava siding would be a separate charge. And initially, when we, I mean, I hope people from Kelleher Drive come out and vote for this. But one of the issues is cleaning out ditches by Bloody Brook and Kelleher Drive and different areas that have stagnant water. This is one thing that we can do. It would be expensive. Kip estimated it to be about $2,000 a day to hire somebody like Cocotts to come in and clean out the ditches, get the water flowing. But it's a two benefits to this is that the water's not stagnant and it's not a mosquito breeding place. And that obviously that's why we're allowed to do it. But also that you've eliminated the flood issues and the exposure to our kids. The one of the worst, there's all kinds of species of mosquitoes that Charlie can get into, but there's only a couple or four that we have to really worry about that have viral loads. The rest are really truly nuisance mosquitoes. And they're right here on Bloody Brook, Whately Swamp area in south, you know, on Whately Road, and up in Wapping Road area. And that's where our kids are. And that's why it's so important to do the surveillance.
The problem is this. There's no surveillance, there's no data. Without any information, it's a blind judgment call. We're doing the right thing. The other part of this problem is
the diseases that we're being introduced to, if you think 20 years ago, we didn't talk about these types of diseases. There's a change in the environment that's causing these diseases to spread also. This is an infancy program. If this gets established, this is going to be small scale. It's just the first step towards trying to move forward with a different approach to this.
It's just like 20 years ago when my kids, I had four wild kids that would run around in the woods and they were outside all day. I never took a tick off my kids. Same yard, same place. My grandkids cannot go across the yard without having tick checks. This is the kind of thing we're faced with mosquitoes. And, you know, I've been working on this 3 or 4 years. Catherine Brown, our state vet, has been so wonderful in informational meetings and giving us information. And Charlie can back this up. There's all kinds of stuff that's coming down the pike. The mosquitoes are the next thing because of our climate change and the interaction between urban and rural areas. You know, that people are moving out into the habitats more and building up areas that never were built up before. And we have globalization. Stuff is being hitchhiking over and stuff like that. I don't know. You want to?
Do you have any questions?
What does it mean, the benefit to do the surveillance because it streamlines the approach to treatment because you have information and it bypasses the wetland regulations? What does that mean?
If you form a district, basically the district doesn't have to adhere directly to the wetland regulations.
What does that mean?
They're there for a purpose, but what it means is if they need to do treatment, the treatment's already been approved at the state level, so it doesn't need to have a conservation hearing to move that forward.
If you had to do treatment, you'd have to go through the conservation.
That's right.
The town.
The private company.
You might decide to do it anyway.
Well,
or not.
What would happen is it would slow everything down. Chances are conservation would agree with it. It just is that now you have to post for a meeting. And if you get any hot spots of a disease concern, the last thing you want to do is start posting for an emergency meeting, trying to round everybody up, try to go through this process to make this happen. This streamlines everything.
And chances are you wouldn't even know it anyway. You wouldn't know what the viral load is because you hadn't been doing any trapping. You would just know it when someone gets sick.
How many towns are going to be involved in this district?
Right now, the conversation is with about 9. But I'm also watching. This is sort of like watching. Everybody watches everybody else to see who's going to jump first.
We have.
And we're people are semi-committing to all this at this point. If this evolves the way it should evolve, we should be through the summer into the fall getting commitment letters saying that, yes, we're generally interested. Then in October or so, we're going back to the state reclamation board, which basically authorizes the establishment of this. They can take and vote to take and establish it. If that takes place, then it still goes back to town meeting in May of next year to actually see if you're going to formally vote to do this. It's a long process. It's not a...
I guess my question is that you formerly working for the state, you might be better prepared to answer. But when I called the Department of Environmental Protection to ask them specifically about the ditch cleaning, they said that there are certain aspects of it, but there's still a lengthy permitting process to go through. It wasn't a matter of just, you know, we want to clean out these ditches and have the district come. The district still had to apply for certain federal and state permits to do that.
Yes, but they would do that as a wholesale district to take and move this forward. Right now, the way things are set up, if you hire a private company,
sure,
no one's doing anything like that.
Right.
Until you have a noted disease. Then everybody's in panic mode trying to respond to this.
So, Kip, I agree with you that there are regulations that will not be promulgated at DEP for dredging for a brook or a ditch. We'll still have to go through the same process, but we'll be using the district to go through the process.
Yeah.
So you'll still have the same time frame. You'll still be in the same restrictions, You're saying no, Carol?
No. The state, there are certain wetlands regulations that you are exempt from.
That's some, but not all of them.
Not all of them. You still have some, you have to file paperwork saying, notifying people, yes, you're going to clean out this ditch.
There's also federal regulations.
But it's based on the program of the, of your preventing mosquitoes and breeding habitat. And that is why you do it.
I think you can treat. They're going to have a...
No, yes, that's true. You treat too. And what we're trying to do with this early, with doing the trappings is you larvicide. There, larvicide is a bio kind of not, you know, it really is no side effects. When you get to the point of panic, you are spraying and it's very expensive. Adulticizing is the most expensive and it's also the least effective and it has all kinds of downsides. I mean, people don't really, I mean, you saw the TV. Everybody saw the TV of Zika sprays going around. I mean, that is just not helpful. I'm sorry. We're trying to stay ahead of the curve, be proactive, but also be effective and efficient in our spending our money. You target areas.
With the districts already established, how many hotspots have there been? How many breakouts of major diseases have there been? How many people have been hospitalized, and what actions have been taken to treat it?
There has been numerous hospitalizations. There's been numerous hotspots, mostly with Triple D. And treatment has gone as far as aerial spraying. It all depends on what year you're talking about.
Within this state?
Within this state.
Okay.
Okay? Mostly in the southeast. The problem we're facing right now is, you know, you'll say, you know, no, won't bother you. Well, we're not doing surveillance, so we really don't know what's here. When I was doing this for the state, it was spot checking. I'd sneak into Deerfield late in the evening, go set up some traps, come back in the morning, pick them up, sort them out, ship them to the state lab, and then the next night I would be in Pittsfield. You know, there wasn't this constant keeping an eye on the house, because the region, I inherited it covered 60% of the land mass of the state, and it was just meant to do spot checking. We've reached a point where we need to have better monitoring out here, and I'm not saying that every day you're monitoring Deerfield, but to answer your question, absolutely, if you want to take a look at the state records, you would see there was hot spots all the time. Do you know where the hottest spot was for me when I was doing this years ago for West Nile? You're not going to believe it. Parking lot of Mercy Hospital in Springfield. And it was because of all the abandoned underground drainage systems in the city. They were all open out. That's where mosquitoes lived all winter.
Go ahead.
Can you give us a line number?
Oh.
This is on series 500. It's a Board of Health expense. It's one of the, it's one discrepancy, or the practically the only discrepancy between the Select Board requesting and the Finance Committee recommending. That's why they're spending so much time on this, so that we don't have to spend time on town meeting night, the same, you know.
These people at town meeting night.
Yes, that's right. It's about, the difference is $11,000.
So that would be a discussion for the people
looking
for somebody to vote on.
For you to vote on.
At town meeting.
At town meeting.
At town meeting, you come.
We just couldn't figure out why.
Yep.
At town meeting, you will come and we will ask you to, this is what is requested, this is what recommended, and then people will vote. And this is practically the only discrepancy. Tom?
Disagreement, Carol. It's not a discrepancy.
Oh, well.
Last year we voted $10,000 for something like this, right?
11. Mm-hmm. It was 11.
How will that get spent?
We hired VDCI to do the trapping, and they did quite a lot of trapping because we were able to wrangle the testing for free at the state labs. And we were able to do that again this year. So we get...
What did you find by doing that?
We found that there was four, we have the four mosquito species that we have, that have carry viral loads here. And the majority, even though it was extremely dry year, so it was a bad year for mosquitoes. Mosquitoes are like snow and ice. You know how some years you have way over budget, some years you're under budget. The idea here is to have you join the district and then you do this basic level of funding, which is of testing and trapping, which is what we're funding a private contractor to do this year because we don't have the district. And they were able to do it certain that we have the four kinds of mosquitoes that carry the diseases, triple E and West Nile. And
we're
the,
just
and
tracking
the,
to monitor, there wasn't any,
correct.
There wasn't
correction.
Any control at all.
No,
correct.
No.
And this is what the $10,000 is going to be.
11,
right.
11.
And, but it doesn't say anything, this is just giving the Board of Health more money, it's nothing about a district.
Correct.
That's correct.
That would be next
we got
year.
The grant. We got a grant for $35,000 to form the district.
Have to go to town meeting before we
correct.
The
oh, yeah.
Correct.
Oh, yes.
We
yes.
definitely have to go to town meeting.
It has to go to town meeting. So this is a pre, we're still going using the private contractor for another year if it's approved.
I guess Mike, just as a dumb farmer who controls insects. It's a little bit of a, you know, you're finding out what's there, but what are you going to do about it?
Yeah, exactly.
Deerfield is full of bodies of water, and the Greenfield border was within, you know, a quarter mile of my house. I mean,
oh, well, one of the reasons we did this, Tom, is we reached out to a private contractor. Greenfield and Deerfield partnered to hire VDCI, and they gave us the $11,000 pricing, which was reduced about half. And the reason why is that they are coming to Greenfield and Deerfield both. And that $11,000 covered the trapping so that we could ascertain where the habitats were of the four mosquito types that carry the diseases that we're concerned about. And the idea is to monitor them and to find out when they carry a disease, you know, that's why you do it on a weekly basis.
Carolyn, once you found out that we had the four types of mosquitoes, what did they do about it?
Oh, they didn't do anything because they tested them and they were nothing showed up last year,
right.
Because it was extremely dry year. Yeah. So we didn't have to do anything. Mm-hmm. But what would happen, like the year before, West Nile disease, the state randomly came out and trapped mosquitoes at Cheapside Bridge, and they were full of West Nile disease. One trapping, and we didn't know about it till 10 days later, and it was
But 10 days later, what did they do about it?
Nothing.
So
nothing.
We're going to test. We're going to look at all of these mosquitoes, but we're not going to do anything about them.
Of course we are.
That's not correct.
No.
That's not correct.
Okay. I'm just concerned that we're testing, but we're not doing anything.
The state has protocols and thresholds relative to the amount of positive viruses that they're determining, and that threat-based calendar, if I use it that way, basically says that, you know, if you only are getting a few body hits and stuff, you let the general population know that there's something going on here, you know, put some DEET on, pay attention to what you're doing, that kind of stuff. If it starts ramping up and you start seeing people in the hospital and stuff like that, you may be ramping up to the extreme. We're talking West Nile now. If we start talking encephalitis like triple E or something like that, then all bets are off. We're really in a serious mode. But the whole idea of doing the testing is to give advance notice to the population, not tell everybody when they're in the hospital that there's a problem.
That would be, without testing, that would be the first indication that we have a problem is people are hospitalized. And the whole point of testing is if there's a viral load that we need to notify people about, it goes out immediately. You would be getting our red code red call, right? Everybody would get a code red call saying this is what we're finding in town. And then what we would do would the district, hopefully we'd have a district by then, but we would certainly consult with state people to find out what we would have to do to do the lava siding and to take care of it.
McMahon?
Oh, yes.
Say first, he's been extremely patient.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize you had...
That's okay. I have two questions. When are mosquitoes most active?
evening, early morning.
Evening meaning five?
When the sun goes down.
When the sun goes down.
The sun drives it. They dry in the sunlight.
Okay.
So the sun's...
So if we have evening activities within an area of potential hazard, should we restrict those activities?
Depending on what the surveillance indication is and what the Department of Public Health recommends, you could very well end up in a situation of no more ballpark playing,
that's
that kind
point.
Of stuff. It has happened in the past. Depends on the type of disease, and it depends on what seems to be prevalent, that's how bad this is. That becomes a judgment call with the doctors.
So last year's testing showed we had the mosquitoes, but no mosquito had was a carrier.
That's
they
right.
were all carriers, but the point
no.
was that the percentage wasn't enough to trigger a reaction to it. Let me flip it a different way. You probably have a couple of people in town right now with tuberculosis. You probably have a few people in town with hepatitis. You don't know about them.
Right.
They're being treated. Everything is fine. But let's say one of those persons with tuberculosis decided to go to driving school with the kids, okay, and their kid also. And all of a sudden you discover that you have an active tuberculosis case and you have 50 kids that were in driving school. Now all of a sudden you're testing 50 kids. Just to use a little different way of looking at this. That's the whole purpose of surveillance, is the trigger to see if there's a need. You have to appreciate also, Carolyn keeps talking about district, but today's budget, as I'm understanding it, is basically just to hire a company to do surveillance this year.
It's just to do their surveillance and to give us the data so that when we move into the district, this underlying data will provide us is in the district the ability to clean the ditches, have a proactive plan, do something beyond just surveillance.
So my second question is that the period of time we're doing the testing should be now, starting now.
Soon, yeah.
And ending in when
you're,
first
you're
frost.
You're probably looking at testing in June to, we'll say, October.
June or
first
October.
Frost.
So if we... Are we
that's
gonna
what
get
we
results?
Did last. That's what we did last year.
Are we going to get results on a weekly basis?
Well, that's what we did. Yes.
And if we find something, then we will report it to the state.
The state will get the report because they'll be doing the testing.
No.
What will happen is that result will trigger them responding to your Board of Health as to what they should be doing. And because it's a holistic approach, they'll be looking at data from other cities and towns that are doing testing out here. There's going to be some.
So the free testing we're having done at UMass, that those
no,
results
at the state lab.
The
state lab.
At the state lab. We have the state doing it for free.
Okay.
And they would be notifying us. I mean, what we got was weekly reports of the testing, you know, what was in the testing. Right. What they tested, they gave us the weekly report. And what we would do would, based on that information, I would call Lynn Carey, the superintendent, and say, listen, we can't have outdoor sports, and this is why. We have a viral load of, this is what's circulating.
Would this be a recommendation from the state, or would this be the Board of Health?
I would make the Board of Health decision. I have absolutely no problem.
The state would make a recommendation to the Board of Health.
And okay. I would have
I
no problems doing it.
I understand.
That's the whole purpose of doing this, is to protect our kids.
And the elderly.
And the elderly, because those are the two groups that are most susceptible to West Nile. Yes?
With the contents of the results of this, how long does it take from the time they pick up the samples, put it to the state, and then you get the information as to whether it's something that we have to do something about right away, or what is the time frame of all this taking place?
Good
and
question.
My other full question is, after this year, when you have the results of this, is this going to be in your budget every year from now on? And who's going to head up this district?
Okay, Charlie, why don't you answer
right,
those?
The first question of how long is turnaround
should
be less than a week. Typically what happens is when the trapping is done, they're collected the following morning, they're segregated, and and they ship to the lab. We'll say that they turn around time, and it takes 2 days for them to take and do the genomes and stuff. So yeah, within a week, you should have that result. The second question was, refresh my memory.
Actually, Charlie, we had results usually within 2 or 3 days.
I know, but I'd much rather say a week again.
I know, okay.
It's much nicer to be faster when you tell somebody.
Okay.
You know, it's sort of like you're going to build this car.
But I was actually really impressed. They were very good.
I mean, typically when I used to do it, I used to know within 2 days easily.
The second question was, who would man up and run the district if we got...
That was the third question.
Oh, I'm sorry. You had a second?
The second question was, will this be in the budget all?
Oh, yes, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, it will.
And the short answer is, that's up to you.
Yeah, it's up to you, really.
And the third answer of who'd run the district? Well, first of all, that would have to go to the next annual town meeting, which would be May 2018. And then you guys would have to decide if you really want to join the district. And if you did, then one member of each town would end up being on the committee that oversees the operation of the district.
It's a voluntary contribution. This is why it was a big deal to get the vote from the state, because most people, it's just an assessment off the cherry sheet. But I can tell you as a select board, not interested. We already have too much coming off on the cherry sheet. We have no ability to control. So the idea here is that it's voluntary contributions, therefore you can keep it as low as possible. The idea is to get as many communities as possible. We're anticipating, like Charlie said, at least 9, and hopefully we'll get more, and therefore it will be cheaper. So the idea is to get as many as possible so we can get like down to 5,000 would be your sustaining contribution, and that would be the amount that's in the Board of Health expense.
Carolyn, or whomever wants to answer this, I don't doubt that there's an importance here, but my question is, if it is that important, why is the town of Deerfield doing this? Why isn't the state doing this? The state of Massachusetts.
Charlie, can you answer that?
Wow. Why isn't the state doing a lot of things?
Well,
typically you don't see the Commonwealth respond to something until it's a dire emergency. Day-to-day maintenance and monitoring, stuff of that nature, you do not see the Commonwealth do this. If you watch even the other mosquito control districts, they don't depend on the state. They just do their thing and keep going. The problem still comes down to, just like your face does with your budget, the state doesn't have money in their budget to just simply do this.
Do they have the wherewithal? Do they have the ability to do it?
Let me put it to you this way. When I worked for the Commonwealth, when West Nile started to show up in this region, they redirected me from emergency preparedness to start doing mosquito monitoring. So they pulled me out of one of their other programs, a critical program, to work on this for them. Once they got established the baselines, they felt they had a handle on it, and let's face it, the larger population centers are in eastern Massachusetts, which have mosquito control districts, they pulled away the funding for that operation. Then they moved me into inspecting prisons. I've had quite the...
They have mosquitoes in prisons too?
Of course.
Depends on what they were built on.
You know.
Was there any other questions? Yes.
I do have a question. So we're going to, if we approve this, are you suggesting that the selectmen will say, yes, the select board will say we want to spend $11,000 more than what we said?
Yes, that's what we're doing. It's printed on the warrant.
So you're trying to 11,000 out of a budget of $1 million
of our overall budget, $15 million. Well, I mean,
at town meeting.
Yes, it has to be voted on at town meeting on Monday. But you know that this is the one thing that we hadn't agreed on, and so that was why Charlie.
Well, Carolyn, you asked me to come here, and you guys have asked me to come here for various issues over the years. I've always tried to help. I think I've talked myself out with this one.
I don't know what else I can say. It really comes down to all of you to decide if you feel this is a priority in your community or not. And with that, I'd like to close and go home.
Thank you, Charlie. I sincerely appreciate you coming.
I appreciate your insight, for sure.
Yeah.
It was fun, wasn't it?
Yes.
Don't go outside, it's dark.
Well, I appreciate it very much.
Thank you.
The only thing that I'd like to say, because I'm opposed to this, is that I think that it is a serious situation, but regardless of our findings, we're not all going to be confined to our house. We're going to take it seriously. I just happen to have had animals for quite some time. I spray our animals. I used to spray my children. I spray myself. Very diligent about not getting bit and taking as much precautions. And I think that's what the Board of Health, we would do to you. So I would say, instead of spending $11,000 to trap mosquitoes, just, they're all dangerous, and be careful of them. And to your point, it's only $11,000. I can pick out 100 things, $11,000, that can quickly add up to hundreds of thousands of dollars. And as taxpayers, it's basically your decision. The more things you decide to buy and pay for, that's fine, but you're going to pay for them.
I hope people will consider taking this seriously, because this is one way that we can give monitoring and early warning to people. I think it's a health issue.
Am I correct in understanding that if you monitor, some of the corrections you can make are less dangerous?
They're absolutely, absolutely less expensive. They're far more effective and efficient, and they would be less dangerous because you're not spraying herbicides. I mean, pesticides. Yeah, and like I said, adulticiding is very expensive. It's broad brushed, and the downside, there are downsides to, I'm sorry, I just don't agree with using pesticides in the environment. There's already too many things people are exposed to. If we can larvicide, it is far more effective. You have identified the habitat, you've identified where the mosquitoes are that are carrying it, and you throw out your disc kind of things. It's more effective than a disc, but it's the same thing. Yes?
Just a comment. Unfortunately, you brought in the district as well, along with this budget line item, but going back to the district, I understand the principle of moving water, but if your neighboring towns don't clean their ditches out, you're not going to move the water out of Deerfield for to begin with. So it has to have a place to go.
Well, I understand that, but the whole idea is, Bruce, would be to encourage Whately and Sunderland to join in. We have several communities that are interested, and cleaning out ditches, I'm sure, right, will be an attractive incentive to join the district.
And getting back to the line item budget, we have Lyme disease. It's been a fact that 30% of the ticks carry Lyme. We've done absolutely nothing about them other than educate. And you know, if the $11,000 was going to educate, I'd be all for it, because...
Well, we can do that. Mm-hmm. We can do that.
Well, but as far as, you know, just going trapping mosquitoes, anybody that has horses, a lot of animals, it's a standard procedure to get them inoculated for AAA, because it is here. It's already here. So
that's
the best thing you can do,
right,
is educate the people the seriousness is, and make them realize it is already here. Yeah. We're not trapping them to see if it's here. We know it's here.
But you don't know that it's a large outbreak, you know, next week or the week
we
after.
Have a large outbreak of Lyme.
Sure.
And all we do is say, be careful. You know, check yourself every time you come in from walking outdoors.
Triple E is fatal. And the recommendation from vets now is that you get Triple E shots twice a year for your animals or horses because of climate change. It's earlier and later.
Because
so
it's here.
So 6 months, and it's here.
Right.
So... But, Bruce, you have to understand that people are not going to stop living. But if we are able to send out a code red call and saying that we tested positive for Triple E, you would be much more vigilant, and we would, and I have no hesitation calling up the schools and saying you're changing your sports schedule, or you're going to have sports earlier, or do something different in the activity level, because triple E is fatal in 80% of the cases. And to have one death that was preventable in our town is certainly worth $11,000.
I'm not arguing that. Some of the same people that have Lyme disease that are in a wheelchair for 45 years.
And I wish we had a way.
And also school playground equipment. If you read the stats from the states, that's a major, major incident throughout the state. I mean, deaths. There's been 40,000 deaths.
There's a disagreement.
From school playground equipment. So maybe we should ban that too.
One way or the other. Now, I think we should go on to the rest of the budget, because there was just one item that was a disagreement. Okay. So how would you like to do this, Finance Committee? Because you've really, we have agreement on just about everything. Brenda would like us, she's a little nervous about the street lighting. We had cut the street lighting $5,000 as a select board, and you had recommended the 40. Do you want to go back up to the 35?
To go down to 35? No.
Yeah, we want to go up to 40.
You up to 40.
We would like you guys to go up to 40.
Okay, so.
So I make a motion to raise the.
Requested amount.
For the requested amount for 2018.
And I second that.
All those
in favor?
Aye.
That was the one discrepancy, the street lighting.
What was the number?
Who is that?
One moment.
Street lighting was under the public works, 5,400 line item.
In the 400 section under public works, it's
I'm confused.
Four down.
We had, the select board had reduced it to.
Can you just give an overview of how this works? Are people understanding how this works?
Yeah.
I'm not saying who they are.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we were just, that was one item that we had lowered, and that the finance committee would, and Brenda would like us to put back up, which we did.
At town meeting on Monday, we're going to make the moderator read each one of the line items and the amounts. And if you have any question about that particular line item, all you have to do at the town meeting is say hold, and there'll be a note made, and then we'll come back to it. So, but we're not going to go through each one of them tonight. So.
Actually, there is another one. I'm sorry, there was three.
Yeah, there were three.
Planning board, the requested amount is $6,000. The select board had approved that. The finance committee had recommended $1,000. So we had asked the town meeting.
Planning board is on page one,
Under general government.
A little more than halfway down. 1755400.
And the reason that we recommended $1,000 was two items. First, the planning board hasn't spent the money that was for the last couple of years. And we asked them to explain why they needed the $5,000 or $6,000, and there was no response. So that's why we held it at $1,000, or we recommended holding it to $1,000. They haven't spent it. They couldn't tell us why they needed it, then I guess they didn't need it that badly.
And they also have a revolving account with over $20,000 in it. So that was the reason we recommended, just to keep it active and let them utilize the revolving fund for the majority of their expenses and not burden the townspeople with additional $5,000 on their tax rate.
And the reason why the select board went back up to the $6,000 was because the planning board hires Pat Smith from the Franklin Regional Council of Governments to help them through different
with all kinds of technical assistance.
Yeah, technical assistance and notes and taking and stuff. And that is not allowed to be spent out of the revolving fund. The revolving fund is funded and submitted by applicants who have projects, and then is when expert advice and peer review is hired, that's is spent out of the revolving fund.
At what point does that revolving fund get turned into the general fund?
It won't.
I'd like clarification on the statement that Carolyn just made relative to the use of the revolving fund, whether the FERCog expenses can be paid out of that fund.
Brenda, do you have, my understanding was that we couldn't spend it. Is that correct?
It depends.
I'm just going to refer to the, is that even on?
I don't know.
The other one's a little better. I'd like to make a motion to add money for microphones.
We did. Okay. Is this better? Yeah.
I'm just going to refer to the motion in your warrant, which is Article 5. But there's a table, and in that table it says that the planning board has this fund. What goes into it are fees charged for applications and filings, and what can be spent out of it are activities and expenses related to proposal and permit reviews. So I don't know how much of Pat Smith's work is general work, and I don't know how much of it is specific to the applications and filing fees. And that is for the planning board to decide where that money gets spent out of. Now, we have been, in the past couple of years, spending quite a bit of that money to Pat Smith out of the planning board revolving fund. And that's what I can tell you is the history.
So is this article that you just mentioned, that's something that we're going to vote on? How is it now?
Same thing.
Same thing. Okay. Yep.
At the planning board meeting yesterday, as I'm a member, we discussed this also, and that we decided that if we did run short of money, that we can always go to the select board and ask for a transfer of funds instead of use, because we don't use the money, so.
I don't think we have the authority that we can't transfer, can we?
Yeah. They can ask for
transfer out of the revolving fund?
Yes.
Yeah. No, you don't transfer out of the revolving. You can spend out of the revolving fund, but generally not transfer.
Yeah, you can't transfer.
How do they get money? How does any department get money when they run short?
Well, they go to the finance committee to use money out of the reserve fund, which we've done in the past for Pat Smith. Mm-hmm.
Too many different names.
So that's what you were thinking? Maybe you'd do yeah. that?
Is yeah. that what you're thinking of? Okay. Mm-hmm. They certainly
How
can
do
that.
How do you feel about that?
That's fine. Okay. I don't have a problem with that. If there's a good rationale for you know, having to pay a bill, that's essentially what you're talking about.
Right.
Right.
I don't think the finance committee's ever had a problem with that.
What I can also add to that number, I think, was a very arbitrary number. It's like, well, that's what we got in the past, so we'll do it again.
I see.
And I didn't really care for that methodology at all.
Yeah. So do you feel comfortable?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
A couple hundred
at this point. Yes. Yeah, that's the problem.
So I guess we can just leave
the
it
The other
there.
Thing is, I think, as I was saying in other situations, there were other funds that absorb some of those costs, the legal costs, the publication costs, the postage. Some of those costs, some of them are actually paid out of the specifically designated for the planning board, but I'm trying to get a more of a handle on what each board or department is spending so that we have a sense of what their true budgets are. I'm fine with this. Brenda and I talked earlier today. I'm fine with going this route if you would like to support
committee's. Because, the finance committee just said that they wouldn't mind a reserve, and that's what we actually did before with
didn't want to leave them short.
Yeah,
if they couldn't
didn't
spend
want to,
from
another.
They spent all the reserves down, and they right. spent $100,000 that they have allocated in the budget, and they had unforeseen expenses. Yes.
Great.
Okay,
and
well,
that's
fine.
Good.
And I am aware that we are exceeding the contract amount with FERCog for the technical assistance services. So
that's not any of this we're talking about.
What do you mean any of this? We're talking about everything.
Planning board related.
Planning board expense.
So that you'd be coming to us, the finance.
Well, we'll see whether we can pay for it out of the funds that exist. All I'm saying is it's exceeding what was expected this year, but not necessarily in terms of what we've got available. Okay.
So I would make a motion then to move forward with the recommended amount, if we all agree that, you know, if they get into a pinch, they can.
Actually, I think the planning board is the one that actually has to make the request.
Yeah.
They're independently elected.
Yeah, so.
Well, you just vote to.
But if.
Not disagree with the finance.
Yes, and I'll second that motion, that we just go along, as long as you understand that they can come to you, that's fine.
Great.
And if, on Monday, if they would, you know, they certainly could stand up and say, we can survive with $1,000 or even $2,500.
Yep.
Well, the planning board is having a meeting just before the town meeting as well anyways.
Okay.
So all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. So if you look at your finance committee budget recommendations, you can start at the top. There are no discrepancies other than the through the
disagreements.
Disagreements. Between the requested and the recommended.
Except for
those three items.
The three items you discussed.
Which we have discussed.
Yeah.
Mosquitoes.
So general government is actually a little bit less than, oh, no, wait, we brought it down. So it's the same. Okay, so we're going from 887,414 last year to 993,677. And this is general government. This includes most of your, the selectman's office, accountant's office, assessors, clerk, personnel, conservation, planning board, all our town business. Public safety is the next item, the 200 series. Did anyone have any questions on the police?
I just want to make a comment on general government. The finance committee we were presented with the salaries. We truly did not make any cuts in salaries because those were what were presented from the personnel committee. So if you're looking at a $100,000 increase, most of that increase in general government is salaries.
No, it's not.
And benefits.
I'm going to correct you, Bruce. Yes.
Thank you. Yeah,
because one of those items is a $50,000 item for capital expenditures for PEG access.
Understood.
Yeah.
So half of the money is for.
What is that?
That's a money for FCAT that we get through our license agreement with Comcast that's specifically designated for cable access.
We have to run it through our regular budget now?
We choose to do that, actually. Yeah. Some don't, but we want to monitor that.
Really,
we
stellar didn't do microphones.
It. We didn't do it last year. So it's zero last year, Tom. This year, it's 50.
I mean, PEG access means what? I mean, I'm
public educational government access, cable access.
Will help to run the cable?
Yes, and that the $50,000 is actually in the recently negotiated 10-year license renewal agreement that the town of Deerfield has with Comcast. The other towns that also utilize FCAT have licenses as well. And typically, and in this instance, there is an amount negotiated for capital expenses. And there is $50,000 in this first year for capital items for PEG access.
So Comcast actually gave us $50,000 this year, but it's earmarked for that. So we put it in the budget for next year to spend, but for them to spend.
That's close above four.
Yeah. Right.
Yes.
Yeah. Yep. The public gets to see where
they feel. Yes.
Okay, that's new.
Yep.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And that's, so it's generally, in general government, $50,000 increase, as Brenda corrected. Public safety is next. That has gone up $87,000 from last year. It's from $1,024,000 to $1,087,078.
Again, most of that is salary.
And that is what was negotiated.
Because that's a contract negotiated salary increase. Finance committee has no control.
It's a question.
That's our dog officer. It's really our animal control officer. We don't really call him.
It's not a canine police officer. Yeah.
We share a dog officer with, or an animal control officer with Montague and Greenfield.
Why did the inspection department went up 30%?
Well, basically, we're inspecting more. So we have more hours.
There's also a little bit of reorganization going on with our building inspector, health agent, looking to work a few less hours. So there are other people that are going to be coming in to handle some of that load, and those are...
That was a 30% increase.
Yeah.
Are you going to have 30% more people working?
Yes.
Yeah.
We are.
Actually, yes.
Actually, good.
The other part of that, and maybe you can ask to answer, if that's what it's costing us, what are we getting for income from the inspection?
Oh, quite a bit. So the inspectors used to be paid out of a revolving fund. We closed that revolving fund, so all of the income is now going into the general fund for monies for the town, and then all the expenses also are so in 2017, this is the first year we've done it this way. And we discovered that we were doing a lot more inspections and taking in a lot more income, and these guys were spending more hours than what we'd actually budgeted for. But let me tell you, we are making some money off of it. Yeah.
We're not supposed to, but we balance our budget on our building permits.
It more than pays its way.
Is the police department getting a new cruiser for $42,500?
Every year.
Every year.
Every year they get a new cruiser?
Yes.
Yes. We basically use up a cruiser every year for patrols.
Are you getting a new cruiser that's replacing one that's 5 years old?
Yes.
Correct.
Correct.
Yep.
Well.
Right, right.
Yes, that is correct.
Gotcha.
It's rotating.
Good point.
Throw them away.
Thank you, Kevin.
But actually, this year we got two.
Did anybody hear that? Could you repeat what he said in a mic?
Actually, this year we got two. We just got a new Ford Escape undercover.
And, yes, that was a donation.
There were.
So.
We're not paying for it.
You wanted to repeat what Kevin said?
Yes, what Kevin said.
Kevin said that.
I didn't hear it either.
We don't use up one cruiser in 1 year. We replace a five-year-old cruiser. So every year we're replacing a five-year-old cruiser.
In other words, we have five cruisers. Actually, we have six.
And every year we replace one.
And a motorcycle.
Two.
There's enough miles on the cruisers that we have to retire one every year.
It was going to be two.
The next section is the education section. That went from $8,235,934 to $8,522,894. So that was the biggest increase in our budget.
Do you want to ask
Patty, would you like to talk about it a little bit?
The elementary line, the budget increase.
Give or take, they both Frontier and Deerfield Elementary increased approximately 3%.
2.68 for the elementary. It was mostly due to the contractual obligation. And there's also steps, and there's a new provision for a new column in the teacher's matrix for a new degree. We tried to offset that with decreasing other items, but the other problem that we are having is that a lot of our services we're funding through school choice, and we have to stop our reliance on that school choice money, because we did make the decision 3 years ago, I believe now, to reduce the amount of incoming school choice students. The issue is the population hasn't been declining as predicted, so we're still having 2 to 3 kindergarten classes a year.
With no school choice.
And with no school choice in it, except ones that we have to take because their siblings are exist or it's an employee child contractually. They have that right to bring their children. Those are our biggest issues at the elementary school. At Frontier, and again, as Carolyn had said earlier, these are level service budgets. They're not level funded budgets, but we are not adding any new initiatives. This is a budget to keep and maintain our status quo. And we also have, as we were talking about with the mosquitoes, and other we have underfunded mandates from the state that we have to keep, things are changing. One of the biggest changes that we're experiencing right now is that the MCAS or CARF testing has to be done on computer now, instead of by paper. So that means we have to have available a device for each student to take that exam, and we also have to have enough bandwidth, which is the behind the scenes, like how fast your internet goes, in order to take these exams as well. So we've been trying to ramp up our needs for computers and still maintain our staff. At Frontier, it was basically the same thing. Most of our increases were due to the teacher's contract, and Deerfield assessment went up 3.32%, which was the second highest increase. Conway was the one that went up the highest at Frontier, 9.93%. And that is basically due to the enrollment of the five-year averaging that we use. Right now, Conway's growth at the high school is higher than the other towns, and the other towns are experiencing decreases. So the money has to stay, the percentage can't go, it has to go somewhere, so Conway got hit. Mm-hmm. I can foresee in the next few years it'll be Sunderland's turn to increase, because right now they're really the only ones that are having population increases.
Yep.
So when those children matriculate up to Frontier, it'll be Sunderland's turn to take a lot of that burden. But right now Deerfield has stayed pretty stable, I think, for the past 2 years with about a 3% increase on the assessment.
Did anyone have any questions of Patty? All right.
Thank you, Patty.
Thank you, Patty. Next section is the public works section. As you can see, our snow and ice is $85,000 is the total amount we fund every year, and then we pay additional if we have a bad year. This year we have $117,000 extra in snow and ice removal costs. A couple of years ago, we actually didn't even spend the 85, and then it rolls back into the general fund. So it's just, you know, the amount we use every year. Did anyone have any other questions related? Because Kevin is here.
Transfer station expenses down. Why?
Transfer
station expenses down by $3,000.
$2,600. Basically, what we did was we just relooked at things, and long story short, I'm just trying to save money, so I cut as much as I could. As a matter of fact, my entire budget is down $8,777. So I've been asking for less money than I asked for last year, trying to do my best for the taxpayer, which I am one also.
We're constantly trying to figure out ways to
come out of the transfer station. Relate to that.
It helps. One of the things that really helps, and I'm not trying to bash anybody, but the people that are out there that are using the station, you really need to buy the sticker, because the sticker is what helps drive the whole thing. Continually, even up until Tuesday of this past week, we're still sending people away because they have not bought a sticker. I buy a sticker, you buy a sticker, you buy a sticker, everybody needs to buy a sticker. Bottom line.
Have they been paid a fine?
No, because there is nothing really set for
it. Well, I thought we did set 2 years ago.
We did, and there was so much pushback because I was very aggravated as one person that always buys my sticker. It's really annoying to drive through the transfer station and see people without stickers. And so we did. We introduced a fine, and
So I can institute that? I'd love to.
There was pushback on that from one of our other selectmen who was fined.
Oh, is that right?
Well, you know, I'd like to comment on that
fun.
Because I see this all the time myself. I'm only up there for 5 minutes, and I'll see 2 to 3 cars without stickers on. And you know, we have a policy: if you're an hour late with your dog license, you get a $50 fine. But yet, the stickers at the dump at the transfer station expire on June 30. We give them a month's leeway, and then it's another 2 weeks after that before we start any kind of enforcements, which is a couple hours for one day, and then nothing for another couple weeks, and nothing for the rest of the year. And I'm sorry, but I don't mean to make a big deal out of it, but everybody that used that transfer station without paying for it are stealing out of anybody's pocket that has paid for that sticker. The goal has been right along for that transfer station to be somewhat self-sufficient. So therefore, everybody that does faithfully buy their sticker has to pay more for the ones that are not paying for their stickers. And it's become quite a problem. It was getting better, but I can see it going backwards this year quite a lot.
Well, I'm certainly open to have fines again, but I would like to just speak in Barbara's defense that the dog licenses and the excise tax and the real estate taxes, the interests are paid and the charges are state mandated. So please don't get mad at Barbara.
No, it was not directed at Barbara. Okay, it was directed on the situation. We have a fine situation, yep, which is debt regulated. I understand
I'm
that. We had a fine situation at the dump, and we that seems fine because one individual had an issue with it. Now, you have half the population with dogs that have an issue with that one, but it doesn't do any good.
Well,
and I'm not there again. I'm not pointing at
Bruce, you. I'm perfectly okay. We'll put it on the agenda for the next selectmen's meeting, and we will take a recommendation from Kevin, and we will reinstitute fines if you do not buy your transfer station sticker. Because I'm perfectly
thank you from a lot of people.
I'm perfectly okay with that, and that was.
Not using the sticker.
Huh?
Are still selling
transfer
stickers.
I mean, I don't go up there. It's not as though they don't turn them away. With the two of them up there, they still get. Someone came in today that had to get their transfer station sticker. So I think guys do a good job. Throughout the year, we are continually selling transfer station stickers because they got turned away at the dump. So they do.
Great. But they should be paying double. And I think that was, they should be paying double what everybody else pays if they wait for 9 months not to, for free.
Yeah, it's hard to negotiate with them if they just got the town.
Yeah, what if
the
you,
town.
Right.
Just move to town.
So welcome to spend a day with me.
Sorry I brought it up. It was just a sore issue with myself, too.
Yeah.
Well, what we did before is we agreed on a fine, and then when Bud or whoever's up at the transfer station catches someone, they have to come down and pay the sticker plus the fine.
And I know, but so does Bud call? How do you know that somebody should be fined?
Because Barbara will only sell you a sticker when we had the fine before. It was Mary. And you had to prove that you just moved to town or you just stopped commercial delivery and made up your mind that you wanted to go to the transfer station again or something. You had to bring in an old bill or whatever.
Okay. Yeah, but I guess what I don't understand is hypothetically, somebody comes in, they have no sticker, then what happens, apart from they have to get a sticker, but what if they don't get a sticker? Is there some way
they can't use the dump?
Keeping track or lying and collecting?
I don't know, Mary, did you have any, you didn't handle the fines before.
Yes, and there was one, and it stopped at that point, remember? What they did was they issued the fine. It didn't have anything to do with buying another sticker, buying a sticker. They issued a letter to them saying they were fined so much money.
A little, you filled out the form.
Right.
You filled out the form with the person's register, you know.
Having them buy a sticker and paying a fine is a much better idea.
It went with the plate of the car.
Well, I guess what I don't understand is somebody comes in and they dump the stuff, they don't have a sticker. So, okay, I understand that if that person wants to get a sticker, then they can't get one until they pay the fine. What if they don't want to get a sticker? What if, I mean, is there some way of tracking those people so
that... What part, they're turned away?
Well, they're supposed to be turned away. They're not supposed to be dumping.
No, and in all fairness to the tenants at the landfill too, they're pretty busy. They're not being hired to confront people to begin with. So, you know, there has to be a whole policy change, not just saying, well, you know, ask this guy about a sticker. They do not have police authority, and they are not getting paid, which none of the town employees other than the select board and the police department are hired to do any confrontation with anybody. So it has to be a policy change as to how it's going to be enforced.
Is there a percentage of how much this happens? Like, is it 10% of the people, 20% of the people who actually use
it? When we did this the last time, it was pretty, to me, my understanding was it was pretty fragrant.
Yeah.
Well, how many do we sell a year?
It was
I think it's much better.
It's much better now.
The guys at the transportation
are doing a really good job.
And the police department is pretty good because they send a police officer out there periodically, you know, in the summer.
Here's just a quick question I have, and I think it's probably mirroring what he's asking. Okay, I go in there, I don't have a sticker, I dump my trash, you hand me this piece of paper, I go, yeah, okay, cool, thanks, see you later.
Goes in the trash.
What happens from there? Do they not get their car re-registered, like if you don't pay your excise tax? Does it go on top and then all of a sudden this money is put against a lien against your house? What is the teeth behind this besides a piece of paper is what they're asking?
I don't think there is one right now, is there?
We have to work that out.
Yeah.
We don't have.
Well, not only that, they're not supposed to dump.
It's on the next town meeting.
They're not supposed to dump.
How much is the sticker?
$65.
And every year, on every once, it's 30. An extra $35 is added.
But they.
And then you write back and you say,
not everybody uses.
Transfer station, so you come back to Davis, or you say, I use a transfer station. Here is my ticket number, so I'm not paying it. And then the person who
that's a lot of
uses it, but they would have to, that would be a fair fine. They have to pay $35 extra to us.
Well, I think we'll put it on the agenda and we'll discuss it.
We're going to put a little box and everybody put in there.
Yeah. We'll talk with Kevin and we'll figure out something. I'm not sure poor Barbara would go crazy. I think he'd send out tax bills like that. But anyway. So I'm happy to say that I have no problem with bringing the fine system back, and it looks like we need to do that again. Next, human services. We certainly discussed the mosquitoes quite extensively. Everything else is pretty much the same as last year. Is there any questions on that? Our veterans benefits are down a little bit. That's really goes up or down depending on who is applying that year. For a while there, it was a huge increase, and it had a significant impact on our budget, but it's sort of settled out.
Let's hope it doesn't go up again.
And we hope that it doesn't go up again. Right. Next area is the Culture and Recreation Series, the 600 Series. That's the Tilton Library, Swim Programs, Rec Department, that kind of thing. Slight increase.
This is a big
Is there any questions?
Jump.
Okay. The 700 Series is our debt service. The reason that's pretty much, I think that is increases related to the roof.
Yeah. Right. And that's the major increase.
And that's the major
in the
increase
budget.
On the budget.
$100,000.
Next series is the 800 and 900 Series. Is there a benefit section?
Which is mostly insurance.
And that's really, the biggest jump is our group health insurance. We have an increase, but we also have a numbers increase. And Barbara always tries, as Mary did, you add a couple people in, or, you know, you anticipate a couple extra, and really for the last few years we've had significant impact with having more than just a couple people. Increase.
Well, also group insurance rates went up 10%.
Yeah, the plans overall on average went up 10%.
Yeah.
So.
And
can I just comment that even though they go up 10%, we're basically the regional is also in the same Hampshire group. We have had two big increases, but we're still below what everybody else has been experiencing over 5 years. So I think that they are still doing a good job, but I think that our benefits are very generous because we actually have in our teacher's contract, if you don't take a benefit, you get paid $1,000. So we don't have to pay for your health insurance to give the teachers $1,000. When I came here 5 years ago, we had about 20 to 25 people taking advantage of that. Right now, this year, I'm projecting paying out 3 people.
I know.
So our enrollments are going up because our rates are so good compared to what private industry is happening out there.
In your employee participation percentage is 20% for the employee, 80% paid by the school district?
For Frontier.
For the co-insurance. The co-insurance.
80, what about Deerfield Elementary?
That's 60, the same as the town.
65,
30. 65, 35.
Yes.
And then retirees are 50-50.
With no deductible.
There are deductibles. Well, no. When you say, there's a PPO plan and an HMO plan.
Yep.
And right now, the deductibles, there are deductibles on your prescription plans, and there are co-pays that you make for office visits. And if you, there's also another charge for the use of an emergency room. Mm-hmm. So our out-of-pocket expenses for the employees are minimal compared to other plans. That may change.
So the only way we can control those expenses, health insurance increases, is potentially decrease the amount of contribution by the district.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. That would be a way of controlling our costs, because there's salary increases automatic.
Mm-hmm.
And benefit increases seem to be increasing at a substantial rate. I don't think it's sustainable, and I think that we have to look at all of our options relative to salary and benefits.
Unfortunately, with any of our unions, that has to be negotiated.
I understand, and I think we need to do a better job in negotiation of those items. There's very few people in this room that have an 80-20 health plan.
With no deductible.
With no deductible.
Yeah.
We'll get there.
So just a point too.
Then the next section is the warrant articles. And what I'd just like to point out, which is new this year, is the OPEB funding is $10,000. That's the post employment benefits. That's the gap when someone retires, say a teacher retires, and they're not able to collect Medicare. So we pick up their insurance until they can collect Medicare. And we are at least funding part of that. We probably have, well, I know we have well over $1 million obligation. So $10,000 is literally a drop in the bucket, but it's better than nothing.
It's a start.
It's a start. We will find out this year what our real obligation is. This is the year that is required by the state.
This includes Deerfield Elementary School and town employees.
Yes, mm-hmm. That's correct.
And do we have a breakdown between the two?
It's about two-thirds school versus the town is about a third.
Of that liability?
Of that mm-hmm. liability, yes. And it's just, it has to do with the number of employees, Bruce. It's just based on employees' numbers.
And salaries.
Yep. And salaries, that's correct.
So you have the health insurance?
Yes.
Benefit only.
Yeah, not retirement.
Not retirement.
That's right. Elsewhere.
That's what I was trying to, it's that gap, you know, when I'm people just retire.
I understand. So as like our health insurance pays a higher percentage of contribution by the town, our OPEB is going to increase.
Sub one.
Yeah.
That amount.
Yep. We have the biggest item here is the wastewater treatment expense. That is related to the operation of the sewer treatment plants. That is, operated as a separate funding. You know, users pay for that, and that's why it's listed as a warrant article. The other item on here is the SCEMS Enterprise Fund. That is our emergency medical service, and that actually has gone down from last year about 15%, our assessment. And we have a capital stabilization account, and we are funding that $200,000. The idea is to fund ahead. That's usually one of the first items that's cut when we have a short or a hard year.
Where is that stabilization money coming? Where is the $200,000 coming from?
Free cash. And we're setting it aside for future commitment.
General funds. I hate the word free cash.
Yes.
Well, yes. Free cash is not free cash, but it is money that's been turned back or excess money that we've earned in revenue. We have a snow and ice overage that I talked about earlier. And we've increased the reserve fund by $10,000 from last year.
I have a question for Kevin. Kevin, last year, what was our increase in snow and ice last year? Remember?
Last year?
Yeah.
I want to say last year we were down.
We were less than the 85,000.
Correct.
And the reason we had such a major increase this year?
We didn't have the storms that come through, it really doesn't make a difference whether we get 3 inches or 8 or 10 inches. The process is still the same.
Right? It's the frequency. It's the salt budget.
It's the frequency. Right?
The frequency, the amount of times that we go out. Because, the basic concept that I'm going off of at this point, because of the amount of phone calls that I receive from the public and the police department, is we try and keep our roads as close to the state as possible. Unfortunately, the state, their theory, black and wet. We cannot afford black and wet. I bring it as close as I possibly can.
So we use a lot of salt?
We use quite a bit of salt. We go out there.
The majority of that.
We go out, yeah. Because like every time, you know, we get called out for icy roads,
we go salt.
And then the other side of the point is, you know, again, in the past, we had the sand-salt mixture.
Yep.
We were tonnage-wise, we're more on the salt now, but now I don't have to go in and sweep every single street in town.
So you saw a significant savings?
Oh, yeah. Well, because if you looked at my street sweeping 3 years ago, it dropped by $18,000, $20,000 anyway.
And how much did you salt in for the increase?
At that point? I couldn't tell you because that was when Sean was still here.
Understood. How much did the salt budget increase this year?
From last year?
Yeah.
I cannot give you that number off the top of my head.
That's fine.
Sorry. If I do, it's going to be an arbitrary number.
That's okay.
Is there any other questions? Yes.
I think there are two sections for snow and ice removal. One's at 187, one's at 85, and then there's another one.
85 is what we budget every year.
Okay.
It's your baseline. You have to be somewhat realistic, and like Kevin said, the year before, we used actually less than 85,000. If you don't have a bad storm year, you know, sometimes they will be a little bit under. Although the last few years, it seems like on the average, we're always having an overage. And what that article, the snow and ice overages, is what we paid on top of the 85,000. So it's 117,102 plus the 85,000. The 117,02 is the what we spent extra. Kevin?
See, the advantage of going ahead and doing that, if you go ahead and say, we're only going to spend $85,000 a year, and if we don't, and if we overspend that, not being part of this, and correct me how the program works, but if you overspend that, you're allowed to. The state allows you to overspend.
Deficit spending.
Then it's deficit spend. But if you reduce that amount, so like right now we're at 85,000, and we reduce it, say, you know, we don't want to spend that much, we don't think we're going to spend that much, reduce it to 60,000, we can't go over $60,000, period. Which means, unless you have an immediate special town meeting, there is no more plowing and sanding in the town. Am I correct?
Yeah, basically, the 117,000 was the amount that Kevin has spent over what we had budgeted. A couple of years ago, we accepted state law that allows us to deficit spend, and we could have let this 117,000 just float through the system and let the town accountant and the assessors worry about it after the end of the year. We have the ability, we have the money available, so we're going to cover it this time. In the future, if we weren't able to cover it, if we didn't have the 117,000, we could deficit spend and worry about it after the end of the fiscal year. So that's the reason for this 117,000.
Sometimes it's not included in our annual town meeting, but we're including it this year. Is there any other questions?
I think that minimum also is a qualifier for if an emergency is declared as well, isn't it?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Sometimes we get reimbursement on the snow and ice if it's a huge storm, like a major blizzard. The state and the federal government will declare it, and then we get reimbursed at a later date, and that goes into our cash, free cash. And I say free cash only it's because it's unanticipated. Okay. Well, thank you very much for coming out. I hope this is helpful. We'll have.
Yeah, we should.
If you want to, yes. I had the warrant articles here that were money related. I'm sorry. Yes, Tom, did you have any questions on the warrant?
Yeah, I'd like to know the new article here about revolving funds.
Yep, thank you.
There's a couple of new revolving funds, right?
Brenda, would you like to address that?
I think Wendy could probably speak to it better, but with the Municipal Modernization Act, they now want us to set up these 53E1/2 revolving funds in a bylaw. And then every year you will vote the amount or the spending limit on each of those. I believe the only one that's new is the roadside mower, and I'm not even sure it should be here. I think by Monday night it'll be gone because it needs to be a different fund, I believe. So we're still trying to decide that at this point.
I'm going to ask a question about that. Where is the money coming from?
Okay.
Kevin will address that. Poor Kevin.
This one too.
You guys are mowers.
Okay, what we're attempting to do is we're attempting to go into what they call an over-the-guardrail mower program. It is funded by Eversource or WEMCO, because technically all of the paperwork at this point in time still says WEMCO, because the Eversource is a spinoff of WEMCO. Long story short is we're looking at a 5-year lease for this at $26,000 a year. So we go ahead and we're getting ready to say, okay, we're going to buy this new machine for $130,000 to include all of our finance fees. So we go up, we look at it, we get the purchase order, we send the purchase order to the place, they send us an invoice, I take the invoice, I give it to Eversource, Eversource cuts me a check, goes into the town funds, and then Brenda writes the check from the town funds to the leasing company for 5 years. At the end of 5 years, the machine is ours, free and clear.
But in the meantime, we don't have full use of it. It's shared with some other communities.
That is correct. We share it with 4 other towns for 1 week each. So out of the year, we lose it for a month. Presently, right now, we spend $500 a year and we get it for a week. Because each town, every 5 years, the new town is a new host town. So once the host town is done with their 5 years, like Northfield just finished with their 5 years, now they don't have to loan their machine out anymore. They still pay the $500, which means they get to use the new one for the next 5 years. And at the end of 5 years, we don't have to share the new ours with anyone else. At the end of 5 years, Greenfield gets the new one that Eversource pays for. And then we get it for a week along with the other towns.
Okay.
That makes sense? Did I kind of double talk? But
it literally is a pass through.
Well, I know. Yeah. You know, I understood the program. I didn't know we had it. Revolving fund.
Well, we don't,
yeah,
because
may or may not.
We were never receiving the money in the past.
We used to pay them $500 or $1,000.
Correct.
So right. Now it's our turn to get the machine.
That's correct.
And Kevin's in charge, like running around and getting the paperwork signed and stuff. And as a result, Brenda has to have a way to pay the leasing company and receive the money from Eversource. So that's why we're setting that up. But we're not really clear. Brenda, you think we actually might not have to do that?
That's what I think, but I wasn't able to verify that with the first time.
That will be straightened out by Monday.
Can I just say something about the Municipal Modernization Act, which Brenda alluded to? After several years, a couple years, I think, of combing through the antiquated statutes related to local government finance, there was a major legislation passed, went into effect last fall. And it resulted in mostly changes for the better, streamlining things for cities and towns. So there are some articles that you used to see on this warrant year after year, granting permission to the select board to accept grants. That's no longer on here. They can accept grants without, you know, that was a change to the law. And so was this too, this particular thing that Brenda spoke about. Recommending that the revolving funds become part of the bylaw. We talked about that at finance committee meeting, and we have more information for the finance committee about that. But anyway, there were a number of items. You might say, what happened to, I can't even think of anything else right now, but they were standard sort of taking up time, but things that now we are really more routine kinds of things. So they have a long way to go to keep modernizing things, so hang on.
Did anyone have questions on the comp schedule and the longevity plan? Mary is here from the Personnel Committee. She might be able to answer any questions if people have that. That's Article 7 and 8.
Yes, I do.
Oh, okay, Bruce.
On the longevity, I would assume that people under union contract would not be part of this longevity?
That is correct. That's These correct. Are for town employees that, that are not union.
Okay.
That's correct.
Say that.
So. Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
I believe they already have it in their contract.
Or teachers or anything?
They all have it in their contracts. We just didn't.
No, they already have it.
They already have it.
Under their contracts.
Right.
But not through this program.
Right, so they would not be eligible for it.
That's correct.
No, the bylaw only applies to non-contractual employees. Many of the contract language reflected some of the language in the bylaw, but police in particular.
Thank you. I have another question.
Yeah.
Article 13?
Yeah, here's.
The request is, it seems to be a line.
Yes, that's an error on my part. I need to fix it.
Couldn't see the world. But is it going to show up? And this is the article in front of the grant record.
No, these are the motions.
It's part of the motion.
Yeah.
And so we'll have that fixed for town.
Yeah.
I was just trying to figure if something was cut out, doesn't show up.
Did anyone have any question what we were doing with the property by the fire station, South Deerfield Fire Station for South County?
Yes, I just read about it tonight. I don't know.
What's that?
Okay. Kip, do you want to talk about that?
Which article, Carolyn?
This is Article 21 and 22.
Yes, there's a parcel of land adjacent to the South Deerfield Fire Department that's owned by the town, and we want to repurpose that lot to have a building built for the South County EMS. In historic, I'm not historic, Deerfield Academy has graciously agreed to build the facility and donate it to the town. Right. The building will be owned by the town of Deerfield and will be leased, whatever the terminology you want to use, for the sole purpose of the South County EMS.
So the ambulance service will continue to be housed in Deerfield. It still is.
We have not heard back from the governor, so Article 23 is to allow us to correct. We did not publish correctly the land for the transfer to Natural Bakers, and our closing was delayed this past October, and we were told that if we went through the governor's office that we could get this corrected. And so far, yes, we have not heard from him successfully concluding that. So we are putting this on town meeting so we can correct this.
And pass over it if we do hear it.
Yes.
It moves through the legislature, so we're awaiting that word.
So we can close on the property and get Natural Bakers building, your building. Tom, did you have anything else?
My only question, I guess, thinking about, you know, I don't have a picture of the land where potentially the ambulance building is going to be, but I was around years ago when South Deerfield Fire District built their fire station out there, and I remember I was in Selectman actually at the time, kicking myself that we didn't get involved as the town body then. As far as long-term plans as to emergency services out there. And my thought is, how much land is out there that we own, and would there be an
enough land available so that at a certain time in the future, we might want to have our police station out there as well. So when we build the ambulance now, is there a plan, plot plan, looking at the location of land and what future use does it have? I know it's a limited parcel. We looked at it soon after we got it for soccer field. Ravine out there. I know it's not a lot of use, but I think when we do this plan and put an ambulance out there, I think it's a great idea. But I think we ought to be thinking long term where our emergency services are going to go, and could they all go in one spot? My question.
I don't believe that there's any plan for that at this time, but there is, I believe, plenty of room to put another building out there if we need be. I know that the plan.
I'm thinking we ought to think big, long term. Mm-hmm. I agree. 30 years ago when the fire station was built out there.
Right. Right.
At that time, nobody thought about the ambulance and the police station.
Right.
You know, we weren't here yet. We were still down cellar in the old town hall.
Yep. Well, yep. The
you're not always going to be here.
Right.
Maybe any of this stuff will be here. But, right. So we ought to
I'll be dead.
And my other thought, and we have somebody from the fire department here, is access through that property. When you build something, you're going to go through somebody else's property.
No, that's not
we
true.
We do have the right of way.
There's right a 60-foot right of way that goes
in
front of it. Yep. And that will be maintained even with the construction of the ambulance housing.
These questions are
going to
come up when
this
comes out.
And I'm sure we would have let you go on and buy it for yourself. I'll be
finished. But the problem, I think the town has an answer to any of those questions. We have a hands-off situation we have to maintain with the building and the footprint, where it goes, what size it is. Deerfield Academy has to do it independent of the town.
That's one of the reasons it's hard to say.
Part of the deal.
The state requirements for procurement.
Okay.
So we don't even.
I
know, I agree.
Good thought.
I was on the highway committee, design committee for that site, and it did not fit the highway garage, and it barely fit just the EMS. It was limited because of wetlands and setback requirements.
But now if we find mosquitoes there, we can dig it all out.
We have to clean the ditches first.
So yes. We got your support.
Yep.
One way or the other.
I think it's a good thought, but I'm not sure if there's enough room.
I know they are talking maybe some fields.
They're going to, in the landscaping,
well.
They hopefully will be willing to donate some fields as well. And so with use, you know, maybe there's potential there. We'll see.
In the future, there's land right next to the highway department that present right now still belongs to the town. It's not going to be part of the land.
Right. Good place.
Article 26, speaking of natural bakers again, is the straightening out of Merrigan Way issues. Hopefully this will be the last time that Merrigan Way will come out up. Wendy, would you, since you learned so much in this process.
Oh, I turn it over to Bruce.
I'll turn it over to me.
You asked the question.
I asked the question.
Oh, it's just that for some reason, I can't really detail the past so much, but we needed to correct it again. And this should take care of, the acceptance of the way properly with the right engineered design, plan here that's attached.
Hopefully,
so
after this town meeting, Natural Bakers will be moving in shortly. So that's kind of exciting. And this has been our issue, so hopefully it will be fixed.
Just to let you know, this public way will not need to meet the same standards as subdivision standards.
Correct. That's
correct. So they reduce standards and it becomes a public way, which the town owns anyway, it has to maintain, so it's not a major issue. But just for your knowledge, it does not meet the same standards as subdivision control on...
And that's because it's in the special zoning district.
That's correct.
We do have one petition, citizen's petition, and that is a single payer.
Look it out, we don't need a max.
It just really is a resolution. It just shows the town supports it or doesn't support it. And hopefully, this was brought forward by Joan Joshi, and hopefully she will be there to speak to it. Otherwise, Trevor has volunteered to do that.
What number is it?
So...
I have one other question.
Sure.
Article 11. Is that $743,000 something that's already in the budget? Or is this for, because of the sewer problem?
This is to operate the sewer. It is not really an enterprise fund, but it acts like an enterprise fund. We, all the costs and the expenses of it are allocated, and it comes out of sewer user fees that are paid for by the sewer users.
So it does change every year?
Yep. This is this year's amount.
But this does not include capital costs related to the upgrade of the system?
This is just for the operation costs. And this is what's on your, you know, basically what people are billed for.
Any other questions?
Well, I want you to know I really appreciate everybody coming out, and I hope it was informative, and the budget is available, and this warrant is available through our town offices if people want to come in and get it. But thank you very much for coming tonight.
Please,
I'd just like to make a comment to tell all your friends and neighbors to come down to the annual town meeting. The attendance has been getting a little weak the past several years, so try to get anybody that down that you can.
The town meeting is at 7 o'clock at the Frontier Regional High School on Monday. If we can't finish in one night, we will go on to Tuesday. Because the meeting starts at 7, it would be lovely if people came around 6:30 to check in, at least, so we're not...
Get started right away.
So we can get started with not a lot of...
Is there a scheduled termination thing? Why don't we just wait till everybody starts yawning, or how do you do it?
Well, if it looks like we're going to be able to finish, usually the moderator, which is Dan in the back...
Right.
Usually, the moderator makes a decision if it goes to a second night. I mean, nobody really wants a second night.
But what if it doesn't look like we're going to finish? Is there a time?
Sometimes we've gone...
It'd be nice to have them all the time before our meeting. So when we meet, we have them, so we can do a quick review. So when we walk in there... That way, just to clean it up.
I think it really should be a conversation.
I don't know, are we still on?
So
all set? Motion to adjourn?
Make a motion
to adjourn?
I'll second that motion.
Aye.
Aye.
She gets what I wanted.